Oh, hey there, guys and girls. Today, on this video, I'm going to attempt to do the impossible. Well, it's not impossible, it just looks incredibly complicated. I'm going to try and take the fuel tank off this car. I've got to do that to get underneath and sort out a fuel leak that it's got. I need to also run new fuel lines to the front, two new lines. And any other pipe that I see that I can change, I will change. If not, it'll just get covered in paint and under seal to help protect it as best as it can. Trouble is, I don't know where the hell to start. So I'm going to start by taking the back seats out, see anything I can think of doing. Surely it's got to help. I'm pretty sure all the bolts come from inside downwards, so I've got to undo everything from inside the car. I'm pretty sure to do it though, I've got to take the rear arm off. The trailing arm or the axle, whatever you want to call it. I want to do that anyway to service it. It means there's going to be a lot of pipes, a lot of things going to be connected to that. It's going to be interesting to do. I'm not looking forward to it particularly. But definitely not looking forward to the rebuild part, because that's going to be difficult to get it all up and in there and get the bolts lined up. It's also a bit filthy up there as well, which isn't very nice. I've nice and safely got the car sat on a couple of tyres on the tow bar. It's a bit wobbly, but I don't think it's going to drop down anytime soon. It's got two tyres on the front, so. Oops, a lot heavier when you've got it at this angle. Could probably do getting new struts for this thing. They're a bit tired. In the boot, which is where I'm going to put all the seats. I'm pretty sure there's no bolts in here sticking through, because this is pretty much the floor of the boot. All the fuel tank is literally under the back seat. So all the seats are literally going to come out and be put here somewhere. All this is going to be moved. I've got LHM, lots of LHM, gearbox oil, which I can't put in yet because I've not got my drive shaft in. Some trim bits and spare old pipes. Oh, nightmare. I'm not looking forward to this, guys and girls. I really am not. But it needs to be done. All in the name of owning an awesome car. Well, not owning, but keeping an awesome car. Yes. Sadly, in the UK, as I said before, you never truly own a vehicle. You merely borrow it for however long you want to. From the DVLA, which all vehicles belong to. It's sad, but it's true, unfortunately. It's so that it gives them rights to remove the car from places and charge you money for it and things like that. But hey, this is going a bit too political now. Let's pause the video here and return when I get these seats out. I'm not looking forward to this, guys. Oh well, in a few seconds, you should hopefully see it with no seats in. Okay, not all the seats are out, but I don't think I'll need to take the back ones out. I have uncovered, after destroying the soundproofing sadly, I have uncovered underneath here, and some rust too. Oh dear, don't like rust. That rust, has it gone through? Yeah, it has. I'm going to have to weld that. Oh dear, that looks like I'm going to have to take the a cut out of this and weld that up. Not good. Oh well, it should be easy enough to do. Undo these two bolts here. There's another bolt here which I don't know what it does, so we'll undo that one too. I'm guessing the other side's going to be the same. I don't know where else is bolted to. You'd assume probably down here on the floor of the car somewhere, maybe. No, I can't see any bolts or anything down there. A little bit of rust there and all. Oh dear, we don't like rust. That's the surface, I think, that stuff there. Could be anyway. Nope, it's rust. Some more I'll have to attend to. We knew there'd be some, but yeah, I've got a trim tool sadly to get these out. The headrests are in the way. Everything you put somewhere is always in the way. Oh, there's a bolt down there. Don't know what that goes to, but we'll find out. It's going to be the aim of the game is to pretty much undo everything and then hope it falls apart. I'm a bit annoyed about finding that rust in there. That's not good, that. So that's in between a skin as well, so it's going to be very difficult to try and get into to repair. Don't know how I'm going to do that. It's got to be done though. It looks like it's definitely come through from this inner skin. And as you can see, I've got rust here and all, which isn't very nice. Which has got to be repaired at some point. But I'm lazy, I might just go and get a body shop to do it actually. If I do all the mechanicals and just go and take this to a body shop and get them to do it for me. I'm sick of welding cars, I really am. I want this one to be nice and I don't really care how much it's going to cost me, so... Yeah, it's like if I was to take this plastic cover off, I dread to think what I'd find behind there, probably a lot. But it's got to come off at some point to have a look behind it. But we will only see. So I've got rust here, look and all that I never saw. Yeah. This side's pretty bad, but the other side's not bad. I've also underneath on the sill I've got rust as well. If you put your hand up and go under, there's rust on one of the sills. So maybe this whole section will have to be cut out and welded back in. It's not a job I want to do. I'll just take it somewhere to do it. They'd do a cracking job of it. But I think I'll get it on the road first. That's rust down there, probably would fail MOT. If the MOT tester could see that. It's pretty close to a seatbelt anchorage point as well, and as main suspension anchorage point. I don't think how bad a lot of them are. They're probably really bad down there. But if obviously with the seats being in there, I can obviously hide it and get away with it in the UK. Not the best thing to do, and I probably shouldn't be saying it online, but screw it, that's what I can say. And as legalities go, it's technically legal until it falls off or something else. Yeah, like I say, I'd rather just send this to a body shop and they can cut the rot out, weld new in. I could do it, but I won't be neat at it, that's the problem. All my welders that I've got, I know, are not good enough. I'm not good enough myself, but and I know my welders aren't that good. I'll do the inside of the car, no problem, but the outer skin, it's going to look horrific if I do it. That's a bugger, that. Typical. Anyway, let's keep unbolting things and see what happens. Okay, guys, so this is why you should never assume anything. This side is a lot worse. Can you imagine how big that's going to be when I actually poke all that out? It's going to be huge. Yep, this isn't very good. Typical, really. Yeah, on this side, the outside, it seems pretty clean. Even inside the arches, it's literally nothing at all in there. It's fine. Clean as a whistle inside that. Even on the underside, it's pretty clean too. Take my torch off and show you. Get down on my knee. See what I mean? There's not really anything bad up there. It's pretty clean, it's all come through that drain hole there. Oh. That rust up there, isn't it? I can't really see on the camera. Might be. Yeah. Let me hit the torch back on again. So, what the hell am I going to do about that? That's literally, I've got to take all this off to repair that. All this cut a whole chunk out. Oh man. Not good. Well, let's fix what we can fix for now, hopefully. If we can fix it, that is. Still don't know how the hell this rear arm bolts onto the car. It tells you nothing in the Haynes manual. Absolutely nothing. There's nothing about the fuel tank coming off. It's just, you know, yep, this is the fuel tank. Here's the sender unit. Tells you nothing about how to remove the tank. Damn. This is where I wish I knew someone and I could just pay them to do it. I would do that, you know. I really wish I could just find someone and pay them to do it, but no one I know is professional, and no one I know has ever worked on a Citroen BX before, so, you know, there are people that know as much as I know, and they're liable to do an absolutely appalling job of it, you know. They'll fix it back up together and miss bolts out and just hide them, or, you know, not repair any of the work that needs repairing. Oh man, I really wish I knew someone who could do this work for me. Like I say, got tons of money, and there's nobody out there skilled enough to do this. Typical, absolutely typical. Gotta do it all myself. It's always the price you gotta pay for the car you want. This car's gonna end up costing me an absolute fortune. Absolute fortune. Already we're on about $4,000 now. I could have bought myself a very nice Mark III Ford Mondeo Estate for that, with a 2-litre diesel engine. But no, I keep struggling on. I just hope I end up liking this car when I actually get it on the road. I really do. Oh dear. Yeah, it's a fairly substantial hole there. Nice. And obviously, all the seams as well are going to be a bit of an issue as well. Not good. Well, we'll see what we can do about that. We'll see. That's for another time, though. Anyway, let's continue on. It just goes to show how much fuel there is left in the diesel tank. This was me taking it all out using this very pump from the, you know, where the engine is, and you look in there, there's still quite a bit, you know. Saying that crosses the whole car, I'd say there's another, about 8 litres in there. We'll soon see, because I'm going to pump it all out. I'm going to chuck it in this 25-litre barrel. Actually, that's not 25, it's more of a 20-litre barrel. I'm trying to go 20 litres. There we go. I chuck it into that, we're going to see how much there is. Car battery, old pump, which is the one you probably remember from off my Fiat Panda 4x4 when I attempted to convert it to fuel injection. That failed miserably, and now the pump lives here, siphoning diesel out of dead vehicles. Well, diesel and relative other kinds of fuel. Yes, so, let's get on with it. There we go, fuel pump wearing away. Wires just touched on, no chance of explosion with this stuff because, like I say, it's diesel. Nice and safe fuel. Maybe slightly carcinogenic. Otherwise, it's pretty safe. Depending on what engine it goes in, it's actually more clean burning than petrol. But the government won't tell you that, will they? Pump's not that great a flow, sadly. It's got a lot of blockages inside the pump, where it's been used for pumping things not fuel related, like water and stuff. It's never had a filter chucked on it. It could do with taking all apart and redoing, but these pumps are that cheap, you may as well just buy a new one. It keeps going there. Oh, there we go, that sounds like it's... Oh, I've touched the battery. Slight tap and all the battery leads have come off. I'm going to move the pump around, see if I can get any more out of the bottom of the tank. Yeah, I can, there we go. Battery leads keep on and off in. As much out as we can. I don't actually know where the fuel picker upper is in this tank. I don't know how well that's coming out on the camera. As you can see, it's pretty much all out now. Maybe I exaggerated the 8 litres, but it did seem like there was a lot in there. And the pump automatically turns off for me. And back on, and off, and back on, and off. Oh well. Keep in mind, there's probably a litre or two in this. Well, I don't know. about 2 or 3 litres in there. Pump's come back on again. Electronics are fun. Right, strain this pipe out now and undo all the bolts we can see. So I'm kind of hoping that these four bolts, the one there, the one under the carpet this side, under the carpet this side, and then this one, and then the tank will just drop. I'm very hoping, not really hoping, very hoping, even though that doesn't make sense, but I am very hoping that that will be enough to make the tank drop off. Here we go. Okay, guys and girls, well, we have the exhaust off, which was easy enough to do, relatively. It didn't take much. On closer inspection of the exhaust, it looks like it's had a few repairs done to it over the years. Notice that it looks like it's been painted or something. I don't think that's the galvanized layer, I think that's paint. It's coming up quite blue on the camera, but it's not. It's probably the torch doing that. Could do with a new one. It's starting to go, and once they start, that's it. They just go. But it's been a nice weld done here. Looks like someone using no gas. It's relatively flat though. I want to be a little bit naughtier, I must admit. I want to keep the original exhaust the same shape and everything. But on this one here, I just want to make a nice U-shaped piece of pipe to bypass this back box. And then maybe I might make another pipe that comes out and around with with nothing in it as well. You know, out and around. No boxes at all. So it'll be a completely straight through pipe. Keep in mind that this does not have any kind of catalytic converter or DPF or anything, absolutely anything. It has nothing on it. Pretty much what the engine makes comes straight out the back. Goes through a couple of silencers and resonance chambers and whatnot, but other than that, that's it. A little bit naughty, I suppose, but it's not really technically modifying the emission system when it's not got one there to start with, which this engine doesn't. In fact, I'm pretty sure this engine has got absolutely no emissions control whatsoever, besides probably an extra fuel dumper for the boost pressure, which I've got no idea what that's set to. It's just going to be luck of the draw, and we'll be ironing out those teething problems when we get to that stage. Yeah, don't know if I've showed you this yet, guys and girls. Don't think I have, but this is the turbo here. You can see I've got that nice elbow down there. It's a bit squashed at the moment. But the biggest problem I've got is like coolant lines there. There's not much space. I've got to get the pipe to come up and over into this top mount intercooler, which I know is not the best design in the world, but it's what I'm going to stick on it. I'll put the wheel on now, so I can't show you what it's like from the underside. It's pretty tight down there. Keep in mind there's not even a drive shaft in this side yet, so there's even going to be less space. Yeah, it's going to be fun. Anyway, let's go and have a look under the back of the car. Surprisingly, I'll use this nice piece of cardboard here to kneel on and to crawl underneath the car with. Making sure the car is still nice and securely held up in the air, which it appears to be. Let's get this cardboard. Da-da-da, under it goes. And we'll have a little peek under here. Oh man, I can tell I'm not as young as I used to be. I'm only bloody 28. Already I can feel myself not wanting to go down on the floor. I don't like that much. Anyway, as you can see under here, it's really clean. They've got just this this is a surface here, which I can get off with a small file and a bit of sandpaper on the end of a screwdriver. And my plan is to underseal the whole bottom of this car. It's pretty good. You couldn't see any of this before because the exhaust was in the way. Yeah, the back box sits here.
And I've got to admit, it's pretty good. That leak was actually just a bodged repair of someone cut the pipe off and used Jubilee clips, and looks like it's only a return pipe. Where's it coming from? It's coming from the face full of rust. Or should I say dust? Coming from the height corrector. I'm not sure which one that is on the height corrector. If it's the leak off or the return from the height corrector, I'm not sure. One would assume it's the return with it being a steel pipe. And the only reason why I say that is because a lot came out of it when this suspension come downwards, which leads me to believe that it is for that. I mean, it's interesting. All right, these are just all, I mean, the pipes are in very good condition. It's not one little bit of a rot on them. It's very, very clean. The leaky oil issue has very well protected most of this. Even the look at this. There's actually a sticker here that I could probably clean off. Yeah, can't get that. I need like fuel or something, petrol, to clean that with. It's only a small sticker. I don't know if that's supposed to happen. Maybe it's doing that because it's not. Yeah, I don't think that's supposed to happen at all. Does the other one do that? Well, the other one does that as well. It probably is supposed to be like that. Yeah. Well, you learn something every day on these cars. I'll have to look that up. Yeah, anyone who's got a Citroen BX, if you could just kindly comment if that's supposed to happen. So one thing I always thought of was these boots here. Surely that's supposed to be right at the bottom to collect any leak off that's in here, but I don't think it's doing that. I guess these do fill up with a little bit of a... That sounds bad. Yeah, I know I've got absolutely no fluid in this thing at all, but that does not sound good. I really don't want to go having to rip them things off, because they look like they would be very difficult to source. Although I could probably do with changing them all anyway. I don't know if any of this is leaking. I don't think it is. I just think it's the leak that's come from there and it's worked its way down. It could be one of those things that I change in the future, I suppose. Thankfully the rear end of the car is very easy to actually get to as soon as you take the exhaust off. Like I say, I've not done the tank yet. I'm pretty sure it's just the two bolts. From what I can see, there's no bolts in or around this area, which looks to hold the tank on, and it looks like I won't have to remove the rear axle subframe. Hopefully not, anyway. Hopefully it'll be good. Anyway, let's get that tank off now. Well, guys and girls, I don't know how I'm going to get this fuel tank off. It's on pretty good. Oh, hang on a minute. Oh, there it is. It looks like it's just come off itself. Well, isn't that handy? Yeah. Well, that's quite interesting. So, future reference, everybody. Seeing as there's not really much information on how to take the fuel tanks off these, there is 5 bolts in total. 1. Here. 2. Here. Torch light. Yeah, just here in this thing. There is 3. 4. And then 5 down there. Nice and easy. The fuel tank itself currently has 4 pipes going to it. You've got one on the end here, which is a breather. Don't know where it goes to, but it's a breather all the same. The in and out from the engine, and obviously the in from the which comes from the little tank at the back, which, you know, doubles up as a distance extender. On inspection of the tank, wondering why obviously it's these batteries are naff.
wondering why it's gone, why it leaks. I have come and found that the sender unit has got a crack all around it. See, all around here? I don't know how the hell that's happened, but it's all cracked all the way around, like it's been pushed up from above. So what we're going to do now is take that sender unit out. We've got the float level, which is there, and the sender unit, which is here. Funnily enough, I could have repaired all of this from the top without taking the tank off, but I'm kind of glad I did, because I've got a nice good look underneath the car. And my lovely bit of cardboard, look, it's got filthy now, I need to change it. And as you can see under here, it's a bit dusty and there's some, you know, cobwebs and things, but other than that, it's not bad. I'm quite happy with the way it looks under here. It's also give it a nice easy access to get and repair some of that thingy. Let me try and sturdy the camera. And I'll zoom in on a part where there is a bit of rust that could do with a dressing. There we go, where are we? Yeah, there we are. There, you can see that just there. It's got a very good zoom on this camera. There's a little bit of crustiness there. Nice and easy. Here, what's that up there? Let me have a quick look. Actually see it better on the camera than actually, where are we? Yeah, there we go. Oh, those pipes look a little bit nasty, don't they, eh? Yeah, we'll have to change them as well. A little bit cruddy. That little bracket as well, if we can take that off as well, we'll take that off and clean it up. Cool stuff. That pipe there is the breather pipe, which goes all the way up and just disappears somewhere. I think it goes into the chassis of the car. So as you can see, the actual subframe on this is in incredible condition. Still zoomed right in. There we go, let's take that zoom off. Yeah, the subframe on this is in very good condition. There's no rot on the subframe itself. The paint all still appears to be intact. Impressive, really. Very impressive. But yes, let's just have a quick look at what the sills look like on this side. Let me just position the torch in a way where we can see. Turn this screen around. Let's have a look. You might get me in the picture as well. Yeah, so look at this here. How does this all look? See, this side looks very good. Saying I had all that rust. Yeah, just above these two bolts here, which I'm pretty sure is a couple of bolts here somewhere. Let's have a look on the screen. Yeah, turn that screen around so I can see it. Yeah, there. Above those bolts was that rust hole that you saw. Very weird. What's this here? There's some rot in it. I've got some rust here somewhere. I can hear it falling off. Yeah, is that all rot there? Let me have a quick look up here. See, I can't see it from where I am here, but the camera's seeing it. I don't know, but that to me looks like rot. Does it to you? Just there, in between that shadow. Let me see how much I can get in my eyes. Oh yeah, there we go. There's some rust there. Ooh. Yes. That needs to be addressed. I really want to take this subframe off, but at the same time I don't. I've got so far already. Well, that's something that snapped off. I wonder what that's to. Don't think it's for the fuel tank, but it's something that snapped off all the same. Where does it even go to? Torch, where are you? Where are you there? I wonder what that is there then. It's all snapped there. I think it was a T-piece at some point in time. Well, if it's a return, that's also going to be swapped out for a nice other kind of return as well. Oh, it is a return, yeah, it's a clear pipe block with LHM in it. Okay. Yeah, all of these returns are going to get replaced. and replace them with nylon. These might not be replaced, these are already nylon pipes, clear ones, but anything rubber, yeah, we're going to get rid of that. Like this pipe here, it's going to be changed out for something else. Don't know what the hell that pipe does. Looks like a breather of some description. Goes into the rear axle for some reason. Rear, whatever the hell this is called. The rear beam. Everyone keeps referring it to a subframe, but I don't think it's a subframe myself. It's part of the down axle. Hmm. Ah, crap in my eye, damn it. I could really do a jet washing under here, actually. Clean it all out. Bush is looking. Bush is actually looking pretty good. Not bad at all. Turn that display around a bit so I can see what I'm looking at. Yeah, that bush there doesn't look too bad. Hmm. I'm a bit scared about that, though. What am I going to find there? I've got a nice hole just up here where it can let all water and moisture in, which is probably what's happened over the years. Hmm. Although it does appear that this rear subframe is only held on with those four bolts. There must be some more bolts at the back anchoring it and stopping it from tilting. But if it's just these literally four bolts there, and probably another four bolts at the back maybe, I don't know. I've not looked into taking the subframe off yet, but I might do. It's in that good a condition, I don't really need to, but for peace of mind, it will be the best. Especially if I'm going to cut all this out and mould it all up. Just get it all nice under here. The hole inside, it looks to be only a skin. It doesn't look to be structural. So I'm just going to have a go at welding that up myself, I think, through that hole. Using two plates, slid into position and then welded up. And what I'll do is I'll fill it full of wax all, under seal, all the good stuff, rust proofing. And we'll see how we go from there on. Yeah, it took me a while to figure out how you undo this happy fellow here, this little turning mechanism which adjusts your height corrector. I can't put the thing down, can I? The torch. I was going to turn it. See, I don't know if you can see that. It's really stiff, actually. That's really stiff. Well, I don't know if that's supposed to be that stiff, but it's damn stiff. See, you don't know him, aren't. I don't know. I'm pretty sure I could ask my friend across the way there in the Netherlands if he knows if that's supposed to be that stiff or not. The light turned on my camera. Here it turns. So it just keeps going back to the same position. I don't know if that's supposed to be that stiff. Hmm. We'll see. Well, the camera on this, the light on this is really bad. I should so take this camera apart and stick a very nice LED in there, like a Luxon or something, Luxon Star LED. I guess the other issue I've got then is a heat sinking it. But yeah, that should do for now, guys and girls. I'm gonna ask about on a forum or on Facebook group, see if anybody can source me a replacement sending unit. I may have a go at repairing it myself. Oh. Oh yeah, where was I anyway? Yeah, I was gonna take that out there before I got sidetracked. Oh, I've got so much crap in my hair. Ugh, bad hair day or what, guys? Yeah, I have to redo it all. Because of having long hair. Yeah, it sounds like the back isn't going to come through this wall. Jeez. Yeah. Okay, guys and girls, I'm going to wash my hand. It's a bit of a state. And then I'm going to undo that, and you'll see inside the tank in a second.
Okie dokie, guys. There we go, it's out.
Can't really see the damage on it here much, but it is there. And you can see it here, look, all around the edge. Reasonably in very clean condition. Slight snap. Slightly snapped on some of the pipes there. That looks like it's a return anyway, so it doesn't matter that much. Bit out of breath. Well, that's easy enough. And there's the reason why you need a strainer. You see in there, there's some bits, whatever they are, floating around that tank. Not floating, but they're in the bottom, some sediment. Can't really see because of the odour. Oh, there you go, you can just about see it there. Look. Yeah. Well, you need a strainer. You don't want that floating into your pump. It's all well and good having a a strainer and stuff, but what about if stuff's bigger to fit through that? That's why you have fuel filters. So also why it's important to change your fuel filter as well. Yeah, I need to get hold of a new one of these. Like I say, it's pretty simple really. You could make one yourself. Sheet steel just around the top, two hose bob connectors coming out of it. Not sure why it's broke. It looks like it's been pushed up. Hey, look at that there. It looks like when the car was on the transport, because it got stuck and it was kind of teetering on the edge of the car transport, because obviously it wouldn't lift its arse up for some reason, because the pipes are all burst. So I think at that point it must have pressed the bottom of the fuel tank up enough to push this out the top of the fuel tank and cause that lovely crack we've got there. Now you probably could use some fuel tank sealant on that or something, but no, I'll just get another. There's plenty of people out there that are breaking these cars. A couple on eBay at the moment. I'll just say, look, I need this part. Take a picture of it. Nice and easy to get to. Bang, undo the screw with a screwdriver, just bang it until it comes undone. Nice and easy. And that's what I'll do. Now I'm going to get all this fuel out of here and put it into that can. I could use the bulb pump or I could use the electric, but I think what I'm going to do is be very lazy and just pour it in. Probably do it through the breather. Sit the tank upside down and do it through the breather pipe. It's amazing how much this tank holds, actually. I've drained this tank now 3 times. And because there's so many bumps underneath the tank, it just keeps finding more. It'd be nice to also give the tank a bit of a flush as well, because then what I'll do is I'll just filter whatever's in there. And there's not much diesel in that at the moment. But it's all what I've reclaimed out the fuel tank, so... yeah, it's quite stiff. You're supposed to have a special tool for opening and closing those. We haven't got one. Yeah, you can see where the fuel is in there. It's not even halfway yet. Don't even know what it is, what is it? Sunoco Race Fuels. Yes, Race Fuels. This is what this car is, race fuel worthy. It's probably what it had, but it just came from the scrapyard. Steel barrel that was pretty clean inside, so I thought, oh, I'll use that for diesel. It'll be fine. Race fuel. What was it? Oh, it had high octane fuel in there. Yeah. 2 for health, 3 for flammability, and 0 for radioactivity. And special hazard is not filled in. Racing gasoline. It's got all the tests on it. Costa. Sulfur parts per million. 2. Everything is low sulfur nowadays. Poor old engines, they don't like low sulfur, especially these old diesels. Best fuel you can run these on legally in the UK, if you can get hold of it, and you find also find it's quite cheap as well, and that is diesel you can get from a marina, because generally you find boat diesel is full sulfur. They've not took it out, and engines like this absolutely love it. It's really good stuff. You can also get a sulfur additive and put it in yourself, but you know. Yeah. Makes me laugh. When they actually banned sulfur here in the UK, sulfur in fuels, we had a very bad year for crop growth, you know, plants and food. And it turned out to be the plants were so dependent on the sulfur in the atmosphere created from cars. And when we switched over to no sulfur, or very, very, very reduced sulfur, all the plants didn't grow very well. So they had to go and start introducing sulfur into the fertilizer. And yeah, just a bit of useless information for you there. I'm rambling on, aren't I? Anyway, let me drain this tank. And there we go. I did spill a little bit, but I'm going to put some cardboard down and it'll soak up overnight. And I can chuck the cardboard on the fire. Should help start a fire when I'm more cold.
Ew, manky water.
I do find it a bit interesting how they don't put any covers over this. It's a car that sits so low to the floor naturally. And they don't put any kind of covering over it. I mean, literally, you've got... Well, you can see all the scrapes in it. There's some right scrapes in it. I think what I might do is I might make a nice little aluminium guard, which just slots into above here. It'll slot on the tank, you know, from the edge downwards. It'll just cover over this bolt hole, and then put the bolt through it and lock it into place. And then just here, I'll just have it so it clips onto that and just bolts and sandwiches in between those two bits. Just a little bit of protection. I'll try and do it all the way across, but I know I have got the height adjust rod which goes through the middle. But if I'm good, I could very easily make a nice little indent and a channel for the height corrector to run through. And then continue it on till we get to the thingy, the exhaust heat shield. And then this side doesn't look half as bad, so. Because I guess it's towards more the centre of the car. But I'll do one for that side as well. Nice and easy, that one. Just a triangular shape piece. I can now focus on changing the fuel lines, actually, which are steel on this, steel fuel lines. They are quite a state, I must admit. They're a little bit on the... Oh, let me get on the floor. I'm always getting up and getting down. I'm going to sleep well tonight. As you can see here, look, they're a bit on the tired side. They're being replaced. Oh God, look at the state of it. All this has just literally come off this pipe. Got to pull it through actually, that'd be nice if I could. It's not attached to anything up there, it might just pull through. Nope, doesn't want to pull through. I like this bigger one. Will that one pull through? You gotta love the technical way of doing it. Yeah. Some of it looks pretty good, but some of it definitely needs changing. Where is it stuck? Can we see where it's stuck? It's stuck there, look. What's it stuck on? Nothing, it's just stuck. Keep pulling it. It'll come through eventually. Where's my glove? Oh, I should have wore gloves for that. The coolant pipes are made out of fiberglass on this. Fiberglass webbing wrapped around a rubber pipe. Ah, my hand, it's now itching. Anyway, that'll be it for now, guys and girls. There we go. All fuel lines. They don't look too bad from this side, but when you turn them over... not good. There's some... towards the back they're almost gone through. They're that thin, you can kink them very easy. There was only a matter of time before they was going to go. And I just saw on one of these pipes, so the original lines, because it's got 89 on it. There, look. You can read that. It does say 89. So one can only assume that they are genuine Citroen as well. 89. I can't read what. Oh, wait a minute. There you go. That one it says there, look. The 45th week of 1989. Which is when they were put on the car, when they were manufactured. So there you go, using that calculator, that little date stamp, you can see how old the car is. So this car was built in the 45th week. What was that one there, say 47? Oh, you can't see it, can you? It's all blurred. Bloody torch, camera, sorry. Well, take my word for it, that's what it says. I'm just going to prop these up here for now. It's closing up time at the yard, so everyone, all the shutters are going down and all the lorries are parking in the yard now, so it's about time everyone's leaving, look. It's about time I go. I've ordered a few parts for this as well, just for documentation purposes. The boost piping is giving me some issues. I think I've gone over this already. It's a 51 millimeter turbo outlet, boost outlet, goes into a 45 millimeter. So I'm going to get a 51 to 45 reduced elbow, and have a 45 mil pipe coming up, another elbow coming along here, and into that. That's what this pipe used to be for, on the original turbo, and it used to sit through that gap there, which I can't replicate, sadly. For the actual intake for the turbo that needs to have the air filter on it, I don't know what I'm going to do. It's quite a difficult situation to be in because I don't have much room down there. Not much room at all. I'm also going to have to sit this end of the engine up on a couple of washers and tight, really, really clamp down on these things, because it does wobble around a bit in there. Put some washers and spacers behind these two. Just to make it so it doesn't wobble so much, because the turbo it comes very close to fouling on the anti-roll bar, so I need to you know, just lift this end of the engine up just a little bit. It only needs to come up by a millimeter or so and it won't foul then. It'll just be, if it does hit anything, it'll hit the Jubilee clip and just blow me boost hose off, which it's a pain in the arse if that happens, but you'd still get it home, of course. It just might smoke a bit if you put your foot down. But obviously what you'd do in that, you'd, you know, just try and prevent it from happening just by sticking some washers under there. It should be easy to do. That's the plan anyway. Right. I'm going to tidy up this bloody mess on the floor that I've made here. Boss man's going to go crazy at me for this. So hopefully he won't see this video. I won't go stick it on Facebook, I don't think. No, I will actually. I'm just going to put some cardboard down so it'll soak into the cardboard overnight. And tomorrow, I'm going to try and get the subframe off. We'll see how that goes. Okay, guys and girls. Thank you very much for watching this little bit of a video, and I will catch you on the next one, which will hopefully be tomorrow, because now my laptop renders videos nicely and doesn't overheat anymore. I can keep doing videos now. Thank you very much for watching, guys and girls. Peace out.